I am very thankful for the invitation of Professor Giulio, and I am very happy that he provided me a title, Could We Really Predict Suicide? Because it's very surprising, but nowadays several experts declare that we cannot predict suicide. We cannot predict suicide. Suicide is unpredictable. I have attended several scientific meetings when some experts declared this. It is a very, very surprising statement because, of course, we cannot predict suicide for sure, but we cannot predict nothing for sure, of course. But we can predict suicide much better than 40, 50, and 100 years before. But later, I have understand why some experts declare this, that we cannot predict suicide. This statement means that they want to take over the responsibility for everyday clinicians. If we can predict suicide, and in spite of this, my patients will commit suicide, I am responsible. But it is not true. It is not true. You will see, I will review the most important and clinically most useful clinical predictors of suicidal behavior. And in the everyday clinical practice, if we do everything to predict the suicide risk, and if we do everything to prevent suicide according to the level of our present knowledge, and if in spite of this the patients will commit suicide, we are not responsible. We are not God. The main problem in the clinical practice that there is a big gap between our theoretical knowledge and technology and the everyday clinical practice, of course. As you know, suicidal behavior is a spectrum from pessimism as a normal temperamental variant, normal psychological characteristics, from fusions leaving, wish to die, suicide ideation, suicide attempt and completed suicide, and the three yellow marked statements are the most frequently investigated parameters in the everyday clinical practice and research. Of course, suicide is very complex, multi-causal human behavior with several clinical, psychiatric, medical, biological, psychological, social, cultural, and so on components. But the good news is that suicide victims and suicide attempters, it is a little bit surprising, almost all of them had current, at least one current major mental disorder at the time of suicide, most frequently major depressive episode, unipolar or bipolar. And the clinical research in the last 20 years very clearly showed that the suicide risk of bipolar disorder patients is significantly higher than the suicide risk of unipolar patients. And this way, predicting the possible bipolar nature of the depressive disorder, even at the first depressive episode, is very important, not just for to avoid hypomanic or manic switches and destabilization, but to estimate suicide risk. Of course, anxiety disorder and personality disorder are also very frequently present, but in almost all cases, as a comorbid disorder, it's very important. Anxiety disorder alone, or personality disorder alone, as a single or principal diagnosis of, among suicide victims, is very rare. But you can ask me, what about the 10% of suicide victims and attempters who don't have any current Axis I threshold major mental disorder at the time of suicide? This is among the very few studies from our research group when we investigated the sub-threshold diagnosis of suicide attempters, non-violent suicide attempters in Budapest in toxicological unit, and we have found that 84% have of non-violent consecutive suicide attempters had at least one threshold DSM-4 major mental disorder, mostly major depression, but another 10% had 1, 2, 3 or more, but in average 2.7 sub-threshold Axis I disorder at the time of suicide attempt. And these sub-threshold Axis I, it is DSM-4, Axis I, sub-threshold Axis I disorders are not detected by in the psychological autopsy studies. It means that if we declare that more than 90% of suicide victims have current, mostly untreated mental disorder at the time of suicide or suicide attempt, it is true. It is true, and given the very strong relationship between suicide and major mental disorder, particularly depression, indicates that, like in the case of stroke and hypertension, the relationship between depression and suicide is a little bit similar. There is a study from UK published in The Lancet about 20 years ago. They investigated the rate of treated hypertensive patients in different regions and the rate of death rate of stroke. And the authors have got the results, which we can expect. The higher is the rate of hypertension patients who are treated, the lower is the rate of stroke. You can tell me that this would be an oversimplification regarding to suicide. Yes, it is an oversimplification, but every great thing is simple. And looking at the another side of this problem, in spite of the fact that 90% of suicide victims or suicidal persons have mental disorder, current mental disorder, at least 90% of psychiatric patients never complete suicide, and more than 50% of psychiatric patients never attempt suicide. It means major mental disorder, mostly untreated, mental disorder is necessary but not sufficient condition for suicidal behavior. And looking at just the question of depression, suicidal behavior concentrates only a small subgroup of patients with mood disorder. And the special clinical characteristics, genetical, historical factors, personality, temperamental factors, psychosocial factors, and the demographic factors play significant role in this respect. Because we know that demographic factors, the suicide rate of males is about 5 times higher than females. To be male, very strong, very powerful suicide risk factor, but in the clinical practice it is not a powerful. Yes, you know very well the stress diathesis model of suicidal behavior and focusing only on unipolar and bipolar mood disorder. This slide shows something which is evident for everyday clinicians, but fortunately there are several studies showing that if mood disorder patients attempt or complete suicide, they do it in the majority of cases in the major depressive episode, mostly agitated mixed depression and mostly untreated, relatively rarely during dysphoric mania, but extremely rare during euthymia or after the clinical recovery. It is evident for all the clinicians, but we should have studies indicating that this also shows that early diagnosis and successful treatment of mood disorder is very important in suicide prevention. It is another study showing that suicide behavior in a very famous Finnish study, very rare during full remission. And you remember our study, 8% of all suicides were in full remission in threshold diagnosis. In the majority of cases, in this small 8%, the patients have a subsyndromal or subthreshold symptomatology. Yes, it is very well known that if depression is successfully treated, regardless of the drug, or ECT, or CBT, cognitive behavior therapy, if depression improves, patients become remitter, suicidal behavior decreased dramatically. If patients became non-responder, it is a change exactly the same. And responders, but not remitters, took an intermediate position. It is also evident for the clinicians. And there are several studies indicating that resource suicidality is related significantly to group treatment response and persistent or emergent suicidality. Yes. Yeah. Another study from Montpellier. You see, the title is very informative. And, of course, not just completed suicide, but suicidal ideation, which is a major precursor of suicidal behavior in patients with major depressive episode, is also state and severity dependent. And it's very important to note that both suicidal ideation and hopelessness decreases, vanishes after the clinical recovery. There are several biological factors that has been described that with strong relationship with suicidal behavior. For example, dexamethasone, abnormal dexamethasone suppression test. In early 80s, we have also published several papers. In this respect, you can see how powerful long-term predictor of future completed suicide is the abnormal DST, which indicates a hypercortisolemia, which is characteristic one subgroup of patients with major depressive episode. Another study from United States, and a very interesting study also from United States, low omega-3 fatty acid was a very significant predictor of suicidal behavior. This paper came from the research group of very famous John Mann from the Columbia. John Mann, you know, he's a pioneering scientist in suicide research, indicating omega-3 fatty acid may be related very strongly to the Mediterranean diet, and you know, Mediterranean diet means lower rate of depression, lower rate of suicide, lower rate of myocardial infarction, and so on and so on. I dislike fish, it is not a propaganda. Yeah, but in my lecture, I will focus on the clinically explorable suicide risk factors, because the biological suicide risk factors in the everyday clinical practices are not very easy to detect. There are several classifications of suicide risk factors, clinically explorable, proximal versus distal, short-term versus long-term, state-dependent versus trait-dependent, and so on. For example, trait-dependent is pessimism and impulsivity, aggressivity, the personality characteristics, and if an impulsive, aggressive person have got a depression, the risk of becoming suicidal is much higher than a peaceful, not impulsive, not aggressive, but a man or woman who has a Nobel Prize in peace. Yeah, primary, secondary, or tertiary. Yes, short-term prediction of suicide. I have got this good, bizarre. I know that suicide is not the best topic to make jokes. I know. But it is also true that if an expert is very much engaged in suicidal behavior, he or she should have a good sense of humor. Yes. And I have mentioned that in spite of the fact that suicidal behavior is very complex with human behavior, with several biological, psychological factors are very important, social factors are very important, cultural factors, for example, culture, alcohol is also part of the culture, diet, alimentation, as I mentioned, culture, religion is protective, regardless of the nature of religion, and so on, and so on. Impulsivity, as psychological, I have mentioned. Unemployment is a suicide risk factor. Mainly among psychiatric patients, we have also found this. We have published some papers in Lancet about this. But in spite of this, suicidal persons are referred to psychiatry and not to the Institute of Culture and not to the Institute of Psychology and not to the Institute of Sociology and not into the church. It's very important. I know that it is a little bit sharp, and but many, many years ago, 30 or 40 years ago, at least in Hungary, but not just in Hungary, psychologists wanted to tell the last word about the topic of suicide in Hungary and everywhere in the Europe. 20 years ago, sociologists wanted to tell the last word on the topic of suicide. And nowadays statisticians mislead the general population about anti-repressant and suicide, but it is a different topic. A little bit later I will touch. Yes. We can rank the suicide risk factors in hierarchical order. Demographic risk factors, males, low education, spring, early summer is everywhere, a peak of suicide. But it's not enough. It's not enough. In the clinical practice, we don't see these persons. But if a male who had a low education became unemployed, and he is impulsive, and he got acute stressors, suicide risk is higher. Yes, of course. We know that suicide risk factors interact with each other, and the depression can result in secondary alcoholism, financial problems, unemployment, and so on. And as I have mentioned earlier, the scientific literature collected a lot of clinically explorable suicide risk factors in general and in the frame of major depressive episode, family history of suicide, genetic predisposition and social inheritance, both, early onset of mood disorder, absolutely universal finding. It is quite rare in the medicine, and it is quite rare in the field of psychiatry, that there are 100 studies and all the studies have found the same. Early onset of mood, suicidal patients, earlier onset than non-suicidal patients with the same diagnosis, of course. But we should know that the onset of bipolar disorder is significantly earlier than the onset of pure unipolar major depression, and this way it is an interaction between different factors. Severe depression, hopelessness, insomnia, very important, not just hopelessness, insomnia. Insomnia is a very frequently overlooked suicide risk factor, but it is very easily to treat. It's very important. Comorbid anxiety, substance use disorder, mixed depressive episode or agitation, it is also universal finding. Not all studies have found that agitated depressed patients have significantly higher risk of suicide than non-agitated, but practically all studies have found this. Half of the studies have found a significant difference, the remaining part of the studies have found non-significant but elevated suicide risk in agitated depression, and practically no studies have found that agitated depression has a lower suicide risk. Mixed depression and agitation are very close to each other. Bipolar depression, rapid cycling, first episode depression or predominantly depressive polarity, temperament, as I have mentioned, also very important, cyclothymic, depressive, irritable temperament, impulsivity, early physical and sexual abuse, loss of parent. We have also found, and we published some papers, that persons or suicide attempters and non-suicidal depressed patients who report early childhood physical and sexual abuse have significantly more frequently cyclothymic and irritable temperament. Irritable temperament and impulsivity are very closely related. Cigarette smoking, it's very interesting. Of course, mood disorder and schizophrenic and particularly schizoaffective patients smoke much more, of course. But cigarette smoking is a significant suicide risk factor even after controlling for the psychiatric morbidity. It means the relationship between cigarette smoking and suicide is much more than the strongly elevated smoking behavior in psychiatric patients. A low body mass index, living alone, unemployment, financial crisis, equi-stressors, minority group, and so on and so on. And non-compliance, of course. And risk factors are addictive. And in the clinical practice, we have many risk factors. Some years ago, it was a very frequently quoted sentence that past suicide attempt is the best single predictor of future suicidal behavior. Yes. Past suicide attempt is the best predictor. But everybody can predict a 10 years old child. It is not a big job. But we know that about 40-45% of suicide victims have made at least one prior suicide attempt. If it is true, and it is true, more than half of suicide victims die by the first suicidal act. And this way, to wait for the first suicidal attempt for having the best single clinical predictor is not very professional. And according to Mariu, in the 21st century, in the majority of cases, suicidal behavior is predictable, of course not by 100% precisity. Suicidal behavior is predictable even before the first suicidal act. You will see. I have mentioned that agitated depression and mixed depression are almost the same. And another study shows, together with my old friend and co-worker Franco Benazzi, who died unfortunately 5 years before, another big problem that about 30 to 40% of DSM-4 or 5 defined unipolar major depressive episode patients have sub-threshold hypomanic symptoms in the frame of depression. It means mixed depression. About one-third of unipolar depressed patients who have been included into the randomized controlled drug trials on antidepressants monotherapy in unipolar depression are really bipolar. Yes, and sub-threshold bipolarity also increases the risk of suicidal behavior almost to the level of classical bipolar 1 or bipolar 2 patients. And you can see, yeah, activation syndrome. I have touched the question when I have mentioned as statisticians that antidepressants increase the risk of suicide. It is absolutely wrong formulation because does penicillin increase the mortality? You know penicillin. Does penicillin? Very, very bad question. Yes or no? Because after discovering the penicillin, I used it when I was a young doctor, millions of people recovered. But in some cases, anaphylactic shock, and the patients died. This is the situation with antidepressants. Antidepressants prevent suicide in the majority of cases, but in some cases, antidepressants can worsen depression via inducing intradepressive hypomanic symptoms, via inducing or worsening mixed states, and worsening depression is the final cause of suicide even in drug-free patients. You see that so-called activation syndrome is significantly more common in bipolar than in unipolar patients. And in another study, in patients with DSM-4 major depressive episode, unipolar or bipolar, treatment emergent suicidal ideation was significantly more frequent among bipolar patients. You know, that it is another topic, but it's very important to note that the big development in the nosology of mood disorders, that this is also bipolar. The border is between bipolar and unipolar is not here. This is bipolar 2, major depression, hypomania, bipolar 1, and so on. Formerly we believed patients never have had hypomania or mania, he or she should be unipolar. No. So sub-threshold, sub-syndromal, intradepressive or extradepressive hypomanic symptoms also indicate bipolarity, because there are a lot of studies indicating that this type of patients switch significantly more frequently on antidepressants to hypomanic or manic states, or the spontaneous switch is also significantly more common here than in here, and so on and so on. And this way, the concept of bipolarity is not an overvalued idea of some clinicians, because in the field of psychiatry, even on the level of best experts of the world, it was also declared, they see bipolarity everywhere. No. As I have mentioned, that about 1/3 of unipolar major depressive disorder patients are sub-threshold bipolars, but the 70% not. And this way, this 70% indicates that we don't see bipolarity everywhere. Yes, of course, there are several clinical predictors for suicidal behavior in schizophrenia. Mainly depression is the final common word. Cognitive hallucinations are very rare. In substance use disorder, in anxiety disorder, there are some suicide protective factors. Hyperthymic temperament, good resilience, good coping strategies, they are protective, you see. Yes, and I have mentioned that prevention of suicidal behavior before the first suicide act is very important. And we can do it, believe me. Clinicians can do it, and clinicians do it, but they don't know that they do it, and they make it. If you see, yeah, it is also very important. Non-violent, non-lethal methods in the first suicide attempt. If the patients have a next suicide attempt, frequently change the method from non-violent to violent, and the opposite is rare. Looking at the clinically explorable suicide risk factors, I present as a final, in the last few seconds or minutes of my lecture, two cases. Patients one, male, 22 years old, family, it's real patients, family history of suicide among first degree relatives, father, agitation and insomnia, past hypomania, comorbid anxiety disorder, early physical abuse. He is smoker. He became unemployed during his past hypomanic episode. His girlfriend left him because during his past hypomania he made some promiscuous behavior and so on. He lives alone and so on and so on. Several suicide risk factors. The patients have never suicidal ideation, but these patients will have. This constellation means not just based on my 44 years everyday clinical practice in and out patients practice, but the scientific literature also suggested, as these persons did in reality, at this stage no suicidal ideation, but this constellation indicates he will get a depression, and when he will get a depression, his depression would be suicidal, not by 100%, of course. And other patients, she is also a real patient. The first patients have 5-year follow-up. He refused lithium or mood stabilizer treatment after the first major depressive episode, and not completed, but made a suicide attempt, that fortunately he survived, and now he is on lithium. And as I have mentioned earlier, if we check these clinically explorable suicide risk factors in the everyday clinical practice, we can predict suicide, not by 100% precisity. And if we did everything, the majority of our patients will survive. But if it is not the case, we are not responsible. Thank you very much.